I'm not going to make a big introduction here, but Miguel Alvarez and Sasha Vuklic are going to be presenting on steroid use first, and then on anticoagulation questions. So sorry we're a little bit late. Take it away, Miguel.
Okay, so I was asked to speak about steroids, specifically for the ARDS indication in COVID-19 patients. So not for myocarditis, but for ARDS. So there's a high incidence of ARDS with COVID-19 infection, or what looks like ARDS. About 17 to 41% of patients have it. And the ARDS may require weeks of mechanical ventilation, and it carries a very high mortality, 35 to 45%. But if we think about interventions that can shorten the duration of mechanical ventilation and liberate vents for other patients, this can have a great impact on public health during this pandemic. And steroids are cheap and they're widely available. The WHO put out recommendations specifically about steroids for the use in COVID-19 associated pneumonia, and they do not recommend its routine use outside of clinical trials. And this was based on the risk of decreased viral clearance that was reported in one observational study with MERS, and small retrospective studies with baseline imbalances that showed unadjusted results that were unfavorable for steroids. And these were in patients with SARS and influenza. There was a Cochrane meta-analysis of these studies. And what was conclusive from that meta-analysis is that the association between this therapy and the severity of disease and baseline comorbidity burden was high. So the sickest patients got more frequently steroids, and then the results were less favorable for those patients. But is it because of the steroids, or is it because they're sicker? The WHO recommendation did not include, however, one large SARS study with an N of 5,327 that showed a reduced mortality with steroid use with a hazard ratio of 0.53, and one large H1N1 study with an N of 2,141 and showed a reduced 30-day mortality in those who had a PF ratio of less than 300. And the adjusted hazard ratio was 0.49 in that study. So the potential use for corticosteroids in COVID-19 ARDS is based on translational research that has established a strong association between dysregulated systemic inflammation and the progression or delayed resolution of ARDS in general, but also that there is dysregulated inflammation and coagulation specifically in COVID-19, and that is similar to that of multifactorial medical ARDS. And the cytokine elevation profile, which I didn't list all the profile here, but it is akin to the secondary hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis profile. So what is that? That is a hyperinflammatory syndrome with fulminant hypercytokininemia and multi-organ failure. Most commonly seen in kids, there's a primary form, there's a secondary form. In adults, there's only a secondary form, and that one is most commonly triggered by viral infections. The cardinal features are familiar to those of us who have treated COVID-19 patients. There's unremitting fevers, cytopenias, hyperferritinemia, and ARDS in about 50% of the patients. COVID-19 has a similar cytokine profile, as I said. So what leads to death in COVID-19 infection is the big question here. So what we have is data from Wuhan, which showed us that the predictors of fatality in COVID-19, the strongest one, were elevation in ferritin and in IL-6. And this points towards an increased mortality driven by viral hyperinflammation, viral-driven hyperinflammation. And yet we have no evidence of death from decreased viral clearance yet in this disease. There is this model that was put out in a study that was a paper written by Mandeep Mehra, and it refers to cardiac transplantation patients, but it lays out a proposed model for the disease course of COVID-19. And he proposes that there's an early stage with a viral response phase in which you have mild constitutional symptoms, fever, dry cough, diarrhea, headache, and the clinical signs might include lymphopenia, elevated D-dimer, LDH, etc. And then as the disease progresses, you start having the frank respiratory failure moving into the pulmonary phase of the disease with a PF ratio consistent with acute lung injury and later ARDS. And here you have abnormal chest imaging, transaminitis, and low normal procalcitonin, and this can progress to a hyperinflammatory state in the host, leading to ARDS, SIRS, shock, and cardiac failure in some cases. And there we see more elevated CRP, LDH, D-dimer, sometimes troponin and NT-proBNP. And it is in this last phase of the disease where corticosteroids, along with other interventions like human immunoglobulin or IL-6 inhibitors, could be beneficial. So we saw the WHO recommendations. However, there's a surviving sepsis panel, which is a famous initiative in critical care medicine that puts out recommendations for specific disease processes. And they put out one for COVID-19 associated ARDS. So they said in mechanically ventilated adults with COVID-19 and respiratory failure without ARDS, we suggest against the routine use of corticosteroids. However, in COVID-19 patients with ARDS, they suggest using corticosteroids over not using them. They did put a remark there that the majority support a weak recommendation. So it is more of a suggestion, and the steroids should be used in the sickest patients in ARDS, but there's low quality of evidence. Of course, this is a newer disease process and we don't have as much data. Then there's a joint American and European critical care medicine guidelines, which recently in 2017 put out a recommendation for ARDS in general. Should corticosteroids be administered among hospitalized patients with ARDS? And their recommendation was to go ahead and use corticosteroids in patients with early, moderate to severe ARDS. This means a PF ratio of less than 200 within 14 days of onset. Also, they stated here that the quality of evidence was moderate at that point. There's been new evidence since that time that I'll show you. That recommendation was based on 9 randomized controlled trials. One was in patients with bacterial community-acquired pneumonia, and the other one was a subgroup analysis of patients with septic shock. There was a consistent reduction in CRP and other inflammatory markers in all those studies. And overall, in a meta-analysis, there was a reduced duration of mechanical ventilation by 7 days and a reduction in mortality with a relative risk reduction with a relative risk of 0.64. So 7% of reduction in mortality in mild to moderate ARDS and 11% reduction in severe ARDS. So important considerations about that data were that those trials were small, and they did not include low volume ventilation, which is now the standard of care in ARDS. So before there was universal low volume ventilation in these patients, which we're trying to do for these COVID patients, which is the 6 mL/kg and high PEEP ventilation, that was not in place for those studies. However, there's a recent trial from Spain, the DEXA ARDS trial, which included more than 200 patients. And this is a contemporary trial. So they use low volume ventilation in moderate to severe ARDS. Their intervention there was early dexamethasone for 10 days. The dose is at the bottom there, is 20 milligrams per day for days 1 to 5, and then reduced to 10 milligrams up to day 10. 20 milligrams of dexamethasone is like 110 of methylprednisolone, and 10 is like half of that, 50 something. The duration of mechanical ventilation was reduced by 5.9 days in the dexamethasone group. The low-cost mortality was reduced by 15%, and there was no increase in the complication rate. Specifically, they were collecting data regarding GI bleeds, hyperglycemic crisis, and also neuromuscular weakness. And none of those saw an increase in incidence compared to just critical illness itself. The only thing that seemed to be increased was the hyperglycemia in the first 36 hours after the first dose of dexamethasone, but did not lead to serious complications. This is a little bit of the data in that trial. About 75% of the people in the trial had either pneumonia or sepsis. So not only did we not see an increase in nosocomial infections, but these patients already had a baseline bacterial infection. The degree of lung injury was in the moderate to severe range, so almost all of them had a PF ratio of between 1 and 200. And then the time from ARDS diagnosis to randomization and from intubation to randomization is laid out there. So from the diagnosis of ARDS to randomization was 1 day, and from intubation to randomization was 2 days. So pretty early intervention. And these are the outcomes. There was a decrease, as I mentioned before, in all-cause mortality at 60 days, ICU mortality, and also in the duration of mechanical ventilation is where the greatest benefit was seen. So actual duration of mechanical ventilation in the ICU survivors was also strong. This is the mortality in the dexamethasone group versus the control group. This is a meta-analysis that has now incorporated that last study, and it separates studies by whether people receive hydrocortisone, methylprednisolone, or dexamethasone, and it showed the favorable signal to using glucocorticoids in ARDS adults. This is the duration of mechanical ventilation in the studies that gave methylprednisolone on the left and that gave dexamethasone on the right. This is what the Montefiore protocol looks like currently. It says that if a patient is on a non-rebreather with a flow requirement of more than 10 liters, which is the equivalent of an FiO2 of 80%, and they have increased work of breathing with impending respiratory failure, or they have a C-reactive protein of more than 15, or that has doubled in the last 24 hours, then you should go ahead and treat them. So early intervention with prednisone or methylprednisolone 1 mg/kg for 1 to 5 days, and you should monitor the clinical and biomarker response. You should add antibiotic therapy with doxycycline if you consider that that's clinically indicated, in addition to the hydroxychloroquine that we're giving per the COVID-19 protocol. What is the evidence in COVID-19 ARDS? There is this paper from Wuhan published in JAMA that was looking at the predictors of death, and the administration of methylprednisolone turned out to be a reducer in mortality in these COVID-19 patients. So small numbers, but some early evidence that using this treatment for COVID-19 ARDS might be beneficial. That's all I have. So I don't know if you have any questions.
Miguel,
I'm reading the chat here. Maybe you can read it too, but let me just ask one quick question. Was the study from China randomized? I don't think so, right?
No, it wasn't.
Okay, I think to summarize the several questions on the chat, the question really is COVID respiratory failure like the usual ARDS that we see, specifically in regard to lung compliance?
Yeah, I think not.
Transfer data.
I think, very limited experience, and I'm of course a cardiologist, not a pulmonologist, but what I've seen is they have more compliance than we expect for their degree of respiratory failure, but they still have a very, very high inflammatory state. And if we're able to identify those people who are in the more cytokine producing state, and we treat this, giving it for ARDS, but also for secondary HLH, we could see some benefit.
Okay, the other thing I would like to note is that, the ARDS literature seems fairly in favor of steroids at this point, right?
Yeah.
The dosage, however, is much lower than what is proposed at the in the Montefiore protocol. The Montefiore protocol proposes, what I've seen, 1 mg/kg.
But the equivalent of 10, at least in that last Spanish study, the equivalent of 20 of dexamethasone per day is like 100.
I see. Okay.
Might be
that answered my question. So guys, look at the chat and see, you can see it, right?
I don't know, how do you see that?
Yeah.
So I, a question from Sasha, he can ask it himself. Is it important to give steroids early or late?
So I just wanna, yeah, I wanna ask you that because you know about it because you looked it, because there is a two-phase benefit versus damage with steroids. There is early phase of ARDS, which is called exudative phase, which steroids were shown to be beneficial. So it's very important to give it early, but there is late phase when there is called fibrotic phase, when it was shown that steroids cause damage. So it should be given early and short, you think, or?
I think so. I think that that's how that Spanish study, which is the most contemporary one, was designed. So I think—
Okay. There's some input here from the chat that's, I think, very good. I think it's Juan Terra, whoever, or maybe it's Jim Torres, whoever JT is, thank you. So I'm just gonna read this. There's a very interesting editorial by Gattinoni at differentiating COVID pneumonia from ARDS. They divided the COVID pneumonia in two phenotypes, an initial one with low elastance and high compliance, and a more severe and final stage with low compliance that behaves more like ARDS. So I think that's probably an important observation.
Yeah.
These are stages, and it ties into when can you actually do low volume ventilation or have to, and when should you give steroids.
So the proposal there would be to use it when your lungs becomes more ARDS like, or
no, this is just a phenotype description. They say that in COVID it doesn't always look the same, probably like most pneumonia that develop into ARDS. There are various stages of respiratory failure. At some point they're called ARDS, at some point there's different compliance. When to give steroids, or whether steroids are particularly effective only given at a certain phase, I think we don't know.
Gattinoni didn't address steroids in this really, really good observational. He is one of the founders of ARDS. He didn't address steroids. He just addressed the ventilation and emphasized like that. So we still don't know about steroids anyway.
Okay, so let me just be practical here. I think there's a lot to be learned. I don't think that we have evidence to prove or disprove the current approach that I think the pulmonary team is suggesting. There was a lot of controversy initially. What is the data for this? And I guess there is not much data out there, period.
Yeah.
It depends
on how we look at it, on whether we're treating early viral pneumonia or are we treating a classic ARDS,
and yeah.
I think it's not a classic ARDS, but if we considered it as ARDS, there could be some evidence.
So good evidence for the ARDS, or better evidence for the ARDS phase for steroid use, no evidence except for the non-randomized Chinese paper that you just showed,
yeah,
earlier use of corticosteroids.
Yeah.
Let's sum it up, and where would you put the Spanish study, also ARDS, right?
Yeah, the Spanish study is very early ARDS. So their PF ratio was like 200. People had just been intubated.
Okay, and, I mean,
they were given steroids within a day of intubation.
Okay, then I would say that if the PF ratio of 200 showed in the benefit, that's what you have prior to intubation on 10 liters with 80%.
Yeah, I would think so, yeah.
So the Spanish study in that sense would support the earlier steroid use,
yeah,
proposed by us, or by Montefiore,
yeah,
protocol. Okay, let me see if there's anything else on the chat. There's a question here again from JT, who has yet to reveal his full identity.
Juan Terra.
Or Jim Torres. Doing an echo before starting steroids. We may harm our patients with myocarditis otherwise. So that's actually an easy question. I don't think you need an echo to start steroids. And what we know as of today, I would say, about myocarditis is that thus far, nobody has been able to show viral replication in the heart, either on autopsy studies nor on biopsies. So I don't know that there would be harm to the heart. We have no evidence whatsoever, despite some data, that steroids would harm the heart specifically. Whether steroids are bad for viral replication everywhere else, that's a different question. So I don't think you need an echo to start steroids. And what else? Okay, so I think we'll close this one out here and basically say, and you correct me if I'm wrong, Miguel, current evidence suggests that early steroid use, and I like actually the PF ratio to be a little more objective, PF ratio around 200 may be beneficial.
Yeah, I think so.
And so therefore, my comfort level with the current Montefiore recommendation has increased because of the discussion you provided. So
okay.
I think let's move to the anticoagulation discussion or proning. I'm not sure what you have, Sasha, one or
both. I hear both.
Okay, go for it. Go for proning first, maybe.
Can you see the slides?
Yeah.
My slides now, no?
I don't see your slides.
What about now?
Yes, coagulopathy, COVID coagulopathy.
Okay, another problem we recently started to encounter is that this patients have multi-organ failure, and one of the big problems is they develop coagulopathy. So basically, coagulopathy in hyperinflammatory conditions, especially sepsis, is not an unknown thing. And it's kind of part of critical host response to infection, but it can progress due to consumption and uncontrolled process of coagulation to disseminated intravascular coagulation, when at the same time you have thrombosis and you have a risk of bleeding. So ISHT, International Society for the Thrombosis, and they defined it as acquired syndrome characterized by intravascular activation of coagulation with loss of localization arising from different causes that can originate from and cause damage to microvasculature. So this is really a consumptive coagulopathy initiated by release of multiple pro-inflammatory procoagulant substances following tissue injury, like in ARDS. And really the story is that you have two components that you have on one time, you have hyperfibrinolytic form versus procoagulant form. So this is thrombohemorrhagic disorder. So patient can present with thrombosis or bleeding in different times or simultaneously. And the form really depends on the how the quote thrombin is produced. If there is an excess burst of thrombin, which is really rapid, there is hyperfibrinolytic form of DIC. And that will lead pretty much to severe consumption, as you can see, and severe production or severe bleeding. On the other hand, if you have gradual release of thrombin, there is more procoagulant form, when the bigger problem will be practically thrombosis. And that is what we probably see in COVID anyway. So the thrombosis is like, this is what really happens there. It's super complex, but I want you to pay attention that you have contact pathway, which can be activated in this situation of ARDS by different molecules released from monocytes like DNA, histones, collagen, and so on, which then goes toward the extrinsic pathway, and then they go to recombinant. But more commonly in sepsis and ARDS is really the damage to the microvasculature or increased expression on tissue factor on these pro-inflammatory monocytes, which are raging in COVID patients, that activates extrinsic pathway to the tissue factor activating 7, then 10A. From 10A, there is activation of key player, which is thrombin. Thrombin gets activated to thrombin 2A, breaks down fibrinogen, and then there is fibrinogen polymer, there is a cross-linking, and this is the moment when you start forming the clots. Thrombin also activates endothelium, platelets, and monocytes, which all lead to formation of clot. But also the problem is there is a release, dramatic release of anti-inflammatories. So coagulation is also feeding this process. Once when the clot is formed, when a lot of clot is happening, there is a breakdown of clot by plasminogen activated to plasmin. And then one of the markers we follow is really D-dimer, which is the degradation product of the already formed thrombi. So this is what we are seeing there. The process can be stopped on different levels, as you can see. One, you can have direct thrombin inhibitors as bivalirudin or argatroban. You can have a direct 10A factor inhibitor like apixaban, who won't have activity direct on thrombin, but indirectly through 10A. Or you can have it heparins, low molecular weight or ultrafiltrated, which through antithrombin 3 blocks this process in different stages. But its activity will depend on antithrombin 3. And antithrombin 3 is really the problem, is very often decreased in sepsis, especially viral infections, which will lead that your heparin won't be efficient. In addition to that, there are natural products like protein C, which by thrombomodulin activate protein C, which was tried previously in different trials, but was not very successful. And then there is a tissue factor protein inhibitor. So super complicated. But so there are different things which can inhibit this coagulation pathway. So this, I just addressed the basic data a little bit shorter than Miguel, which goes about D-dimer anticoagulation and mortality and sepsis overall. So multi-organ failure is most likely in patients in sepsis who develop coagulopathy. It's known. And inhibiting thrombin generation may have benefit in reducing mortality. The evidence are also going in both directions. Pretty much only molecule we know that is definitely beneficial, it's low molecular weight heparin, which in meta-analysis large showed 28 days reduced mortality and decrease in Apache score, which is really the score which is measuring the severity of sepsis among septic patients. When they look into antithrombin use in patients with sepsis and DIC, there was beneficial effect on mortality initially. However, large follow-up Kybersep study show no benefit and increased risk of bleeding if you use therapeutically large doses of antithrombin. Of course, that doesn't mean that you should not replenish antithrombin 3 if it's low and you use heparin. Recombinant activated protein C was major, major hope for everybody after initial studies show there is significant improvement in mortality. However, subsequent studies, including the landmark PROVIS shock study, show there is no improvement in mortality and there is increased bleeding risk. And after that, pretty much FDA banned use of recombinant activated protein C. In Japan, they used recombinant thrombomodulin and tissue factor factor inhibitor, and there were no substantial benefit. So pretty much only thing we have evidence for now in sepsis is heparins, ultrafiltrated, and need a little bit better evidence for low molecular weight heparin. So when we go about D-dimer and COVID, it's important to see what data we have. Of course, we have this very limited, very often descriptive studies from China, but in study from Tang et al. From Wuhan, retrospective analysis, evaluate coagulation parameters in 183 patients admitted with severe COVID, which for them, it's usually that there is a PFO ratio of less than 300. Median age of admission was 54 years, 41 of patients had a chronic disease, and overall mortality was 11.5%. Elevated D-dimer at admission and markedly increasing the dimer levels 3 to 4 over the next couple of days were associated with high mortality, and it was statistically significant. And 71% of non-survivors from COVID-19 infection had the ICHD criteria for DIC compared to only 0.4% of survivors, which tells you that coagulopathy either is just a secondary signal or is an important component which contributes to mortality. We don't have, of course, evidence for that. So this study, they put one of these things that you can see how dynamically changes, not just initial D-dimer, but dynamic changes are important. And in the green ones are the values in non-survivors, and blue ones are the values in survivors. And you can see, especially if a D-dimer, the quick rising of D-dimer is a characteristic of non-survivors. And their level was going over a couple of days above 20, what we are also seeing, while the level in survivors was mostly below 5 to 7 when we simplify it to D-dimer. Similar correlation was INR, but not so clear with PTT and fibrinogen. Also, you can see the non-survivors had a lower level of antithrombin 3 or antithrombin comparing to the survivors. The fibrin degradation products show the similar activity. So I think also this is very important that in non-survivors or people at high risk, you will see rapidly increasing level, despite that initial D-dimer level can be similar in survivors than non-survivors anyway. So I think that's important component, to follow up the levels in there anyway. So, yeah. So also in retrospective multi-center cohort study of 191 patients with COVID-19, again from China. In this study, 28% of patients died, which is really for me shocking how much variation there is in mortality from study to study in China. The previous one showed that 11% died. 91% of patients, 91 patients or 48% of patients had comorbidity, with hypertension being the most common, 30%, followed by diabetes, 19%, and coronary heart disease. They did the multivariable regression analysis, which show that the increased odds of in-hospital deaths was associated with older age, odds ratio 1.1, higher SOFA score, 5.65, and what was shocking, the highest risk for dying, that it's your D-dimer greater than one. It's 18-fold increase in the death risk for dying, which really maybe tell us that coagulopathy is not just the bystander or the innocent victim of this process, but that it maybe also contributes there. So then the second thing is also because all different forms of sepsis and bacterial and viral, they have coagulopathy. This is not an unknown thing, but we just have feeling that in this disease, this is much more pronounced. So they had a little study, which is still like in review phase, which was very interesting. They compared the 57 patients with confirmed COVID-19 pneumonia and 46 patients with confirmed community-acquired pneumonia. And then they found that D-dimer levels in patients with COVID with similar were much higher than in patients with community-acquired pneumonia. There was a clear-cut correlation between D-dimer in COVID patients and markers of inflammation, especially high sensitivity CRP. But what was most interesting, because the elevation of CRP will also be present into bacterial pneumonia, is that COVID-19 patients had higher levels of D-dimer when their CRP levels were lower than the bacterial community-acquired pneumonia. This suggests there are other factors besides inflammation that are responsible for activation of coagulation system in patients with COVID-19. So this, what we see with coagulopathy, is new beast, is not something we're traditionally traditionally seeing anyway. So their conclusion is that elevated baseline D-dimer level is associated with inflammation in COVID-19, and that abnormal changes in D-dimer and inflammatory factors suggest that anticoagulant therapy may be needed, which we also think anyway. So then we come to only study which really looked fully into mortality. Again, from China, this was the multicenter study, and they look into successive 1,786 successive patients. And from them, they selected 449 patients with severe COVID. And 99 of these 449 received heparin. When you look in the methods and you manage to dig it out, you will see that mainly it was low molecular weight heparin in prophylactic dose for 7 days or longer for retrospective or longer for retrospective review to EMR. So they did retrospective review to EMR. So this is again additional problem with this study. Exclusion criteria were bleeding diathesis, hospital stays less than 7 days, and lack of information about coagulation parameters and medications and age less than 18. Severe COVID was defined in this study as if you meet any of one of the following items. So respiratory rate more than 30 breaths per minute, arterial oxygen saturation less than 93, and PaO2, FiO2 ratio less than 300. So this is their definition. So any one of these parameters you hit, you become severe. So again, anticoagulant treatment was defined as receiving either ultrafractionated heparin or low molecular weight heparin. And again, in methods, it seems majority got low molecular weight, but they didn't put exact numbers and it was mostly prophylactic dose. So this is, you can see how they enroll people. One problem is here that 76 patients or 15% of included were excluded from the study from different reasons. Bottom line, we got 449 and 20% got treatment with heparin, different forms and different concentrations, we don't know, for 7 days. And 350 or 78 were non-treated. So, I'm sorry, this is a little bit, I didn't show up like that previously. So then they will look in clinical characteristics and survivors versus non-survivors. Of course, the difference was that non-survivors were a little bit older, 68.7 versus 63.7. They were meeting sepsis-induced coagulation criteria, the non-survivors, 41% of them versus 13.3%. They had elevated INR, they have decreased platelet count, and they had much higher PTT. Non-survivor average PTT, was, the D-dimer was 4.7 versus 1.47. So, when they mentioned sepsis-induced coagulopathy score, I pretty much wanted to address because majority of us didn't know it before COVID. So there are three important components. This is kind of now in exchange for the previously existing DIC score. One component is platelet count. Second component is PTINR. And then the third component is SOFA score. This is sepsis-related organ failure. But you can see if your PaO2, FiO2 ratio is less than 300, which pretty much makes you severe, you're automatically having maximum score of 2 there, which is used. So to become, this is the scoring system. So when they did multivariate analysis, they again found that what is increasing a risk for mortality was age, and then also INR or proton beam time and platelet count and the D-dimer level that was correlating with mortality. So then, because they initially, when they compared the mortality in people who taking it overall and people who do not taking it overall, there was no statistically significant difference, they decided to break it down and to look at that. So the patients who had that 6 score, 4 or more plus, which was 21% of patients, if they're on heparin, they had much better survival than not. Also, for the patients who D-dimer was 6 times upper limit of normal, to translate it's 3 micrograms per milliliter and higher, they noticed that if they're on heparin, the mortality improved. What was worrisome is here that if your D-dimer is less than 1 upper limit of normal, which is 0.5 in our values, there will be maybe mortality risk, although it was not statistically significant. Statistically significant, which will probably say that you really, if you have normal anticoagulation, you should not give it to these patients. So bottom line, D-dimer and prothrombin time and age were positively and platelet count was negatively correlated with 28-day mortality in this multivariate analysis. 28-day mortality between heparin users and non users was no different in mortality in all comers. However, if we separated in people with a high D-dimer and high 6 score, 28-day mortality for heparin users were lower if the 6 score is higher than 4, 40 versus 64. But you need to take in account that only 22% of the all patients from 499 met C criteria, because despite having the SOFA score high, these patients do not have profound, and we didn't notice thrombocytopenia and profoundly increased INR continuously. So it's not consumption as much as this. This is a thrombotic kind of version of DIC there. Second, the 28-day mortality of heparin users was much lower than non-users in patients with D-dimer more than 6 times upper limit of normal, which is really 3 micrograms per milliliter for us, and that was 38 versus 52. And 56 of the patients in this study were fulfilling this criteria. So more than half of patients will have D-dimer more than 3. And then again, on the other hand, what I was worried, the 28-day mortality of heparin users with D-dimer less than 0.5 or 1 upper limit of normal, which is only 7.5% in a study, is increased from 9.7 to 33, although statistically is not significant because the number is low. So what is the consequence of this coagulopathy? There are multiple reports coming. One of this is the little study which show pathological analysis of patient with COVID lung, and you can see hemorrhagic infarctions. So this is infarctions, which is converted then to hemorrhagic conversions of the lung throughout. And here you can see it histologically. So there is thrombosis and then hemorrhagic conversion there happening. So second thing, there are multiple reports. I just put a couple of them of patients with COVID ARDS developing PE. Here you can see 57-year-old man with COVID pneumonia. And then on day 10, he developed more hypoxia. And then when they did a CAT scan with contrast, they see that he has multiple bilateral filling defects. So the thrombus are thrown in the lungs. In the same study, again, 70-year-old mate with COVID pneumonia. And on CT scan on day 2, there were bilateral peripheral ground grasses opacities, but then when they did angiogram, they found the multiple occlusions of segmental and subsegmental PEs. There is 2 additional studies from Italy coming. So this tells that this thrombosis or of the lungs is very, very common. Second thing, this is our own experience. So peripheral thrombosis for microthrombosis, this 68-year-old renal transplant patient who was 4 days of pressors on heparin with PTT therapeutic from 50 to 80. And then we noticed that there is dusky appearance of the ears with some possible necrosis. We were not sure, but definitely on the feet, you can see on the soles and on the heels, not just on the heels, but also on the soles, there was a dusky appearance and there was some necrotic changes. And in that moment, we switched him to bivalirudin. His D-dimer was initially 14, and after putting on heparin, it trended down slowly, but then when on bivalirudin, it trended down to 1.9. His 83 level was 81%. So this is one more of our patients. This is a 55-year-old male who presented to ER with ST elevation, but found not to have obstructive coronary disease, a new decrease in LV function. And this is 5 days after we stopped pressors of the patient. He suddenly developed first dusky appearance of the feet and then developed necrosis. We call vascular surgery. We did the Dopplers, and we see that all the vessels in the feet are, the large vessels are really functional. So it was the microthrombosis that developed. His 83 level was 51%. Hit and SRA testing was negative. Then we did the testing for antiphospholipid syndrome, beta 2 glycoprotein 1, anticardiolipin, and were negative. Lupus anticoagulant was positive, but they thought that it was secondary to bivalirudin because it's known to cause it. There was no loss, interestingly. His protein C and protein CS levels were adequate. So there is no explosive consumption coagulopathy. His fibrin degradation products were more than 20 and D-dimer was 14. After he put on bivalirudin, it continued to decrease down to 5. Yeah, the platelets were initially in 190s, and after we put him on anticoagulation, they increased to 300. So it's not the platelet problem. Probably initially there was a little bit of, usually the pulmonary infections don't cause like platelet problem and coagulopathy because they produce the platelet production factors anyway, so.
Sasha, yeah. Want to interject that these images are strictly confidential, and since we're on the web here, anybody who distributes these, this is probably a HIPAA violation. Just to remind everybody, this is a closed conference. Go ahead.
Right. So third problem we encounter, it seems, is lot of places in the hospital we're encountering is the catheter thrombosis, A line, central line, and especially hemodialysis catheter thrombosis, which is widespread problem. So one of the examples is our 52-year-old male who has non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, had transplanted in 2015, hypertension, diabetes, pulmonary sarcoidosis, presented with fever, shortness of breath and hypoxia, and 3 days later we intubated him. He subsequently developed polyguric AKI, which is also a very common problem with patients with severe COVID. Initially, his D-dimer was mildly increased, 1.1 from 0.5, which is the upper limit of normal. But when we start placing the central line and A line, we had multiple episodes of line clotting events. So he was placed on heparin, and his D-dimer for days was coming in low 1 or below 1. But then, again, lines one more time clotted. As patient developed slowly anemia with hemoglobin dropping below 7, we stopped heparin subsequently, and the next day the dimer shot it up to more than 20. As the lines again clotted even faster, and we couldn't do the dialysis, we put him on bivalve, which allow us after exchanging the head HD catheter that we do dialysis. However, the dimer consistently stay increased, which indicated that he has now possible presence of thrombus, which slow degradation will keep this D-dimer there. So there was definitely active clot. We know that he had AJ clot, yeah. And his 83 level was also 64. We check him again, in this patient also for antiphospholipid syndrome, and his beta 2 glycoprotein, anticardiolipin, and lupus anticoagulant were negative. He never had a thrombocytopenia. I'm saying all this about lupus antiphospholipid syndrome because 2 days ago there was a publication, again, New England Journal of Medicine, which three patients who develop microthrombi, especially it was the infarctions to the brain, and from China, and all three of them had the positive markers of antiphospholipid syndrome, anticardiolipin, beta 2 glycoprotein, and we do not see that. So we start testing like pretty much anybody who has the problem with clotting, clotting the lines we do not see. I really start testing it because I heard even before this paper from some indirect reports from China that there is maybe possibility of antiphospholipid syndrome. However, and I think we should conduct even more widespread testing, I do not see it. I really do not see it. Anyway, so why we think the anticoagulation is important? Because coagulation also contributes to inflammation. The thrombin, by activating PAR receptors, PAR 1 and 3, on endothelial cells, on platelets and monocytes, lead to production of IL-8, IL-6, MCP-1, and ICOM. And you can see the effect of production of IL-8 by thrombin on monocytes. Oh, these are QVEX, I'm sorry. And there is like the, or endothelial cells, so there is the drastic increase in production with relatively low concentration of thrombin, and it's even increasing through the time. What is more important, once you form thromb, the clot by itself has even higher production of thrombin. Here you can see if you treat monocytes with thrombin, there is increase in the level of IL-8. However, if you treat the monocytes from clot, like there is a drastically higher production. So there is a potentiation. So having the clot drastically potentiate production of anti-inflammatories and having microthrombi throughout with activated coagulopathy and activated thrombin will drastically produce. And you can see even these monocytes from clot or from thrombus, you can decrease their production of IL-8 with heparin, but more importantly, much stronger with direct thrombin inhibitor, because heparin would not work on the activated thrombin, which is already present in thrombus. That's one of the reasons we are using bivalirudin in mechanical circulatory support, because it will inhibit the thrombus thrombin already in activated thromb. Why do we think there is in COVID more coagulopathy than in other infections? I kind of speculate that the problem is also the system which is affected by this disease, which is cardiovascular system, and that's ACE angiotensin 2 versus ACE 2 angiotensin 1 to 7 system, our basic cardiovascular system. So the report from China showed that these patients have angiotensin 2, very, very high levels of angiotensin 2, which is not really expected in the patients in sepsis anyway. And then the second problem is that there was a description with initial SARS-CoV that there is ACE2 shedding. And ACE2 shedding lead to loss of protective effect. It was shown that in spontaneously hypertensive rats, where you have increased activity of decreased activity of ACE2, there is increase in thrombosis or production of the size of a thromb. So maybe this disbalance between angiotensin and the loss of ACE2 and angiotensin 1 to 7 is really why we see so much more coagulopathy than in other forms. So discussion is really anticoagulation protocols. Currently, our protocol for floor patient is DOAC, apixaban. The problem, everybody should give opinion, is that it has combination of 25% renal, 75% hepatic clearance, and the both systems are affected with COVID. These patients have very often kidney failure and liver failure. Even in normal people, it has long half-life, 12 hours or more, and it's not easily reversible, and it has no anti-inflammatory effect. Other option is ultrafiltral heparin, which is A3 dependent, and we've seen several patients that AT3 is down, so APTT may not accurately predict effect and the effect may be diminished. The problem is, again, for floor IV drip or multiple Q8 injections are needed, although the positive thing is that ultrafiltrated heparin has anti-inflammatory effect, which will help. Then we have low molecular weight heparin, again, AT3 dependent, same problems. Additional problem is renal clearance, which will be a problem with patients with AKI, cannot be used in morbidly obese patients, which under our population is not uncommon. It's not easily reversible. Long half-life will problem in the units. And then on the other hand, has proven anti-inflammatory effect. We use in unit currently bivalve, direct thrombin inhibitor, works also in thrombin clot, which is very good. It's renally cleared, but we have a protocol for people even on dialysis, which is successful. It's easily reversible, short half-life. It's independent of AT3, which is decreased and has anti-inflammatory effect. So the question is, what really should we do anyway? So we have a couple of guests also from hematology. It will be good.
Okay, great. Thanks, Sasha. Let me just get through a few of the input that came throughout your presentation from the chat. One really underscores again that there is a clear difference between COVID and community acquired pneumonia, in a sense that the natural history of COVID includes a pro-inflammatory state. There was a very practical question whether you can give nitric oxide on an open circuit ventilator, and a critical care group does not recommend that. There's a comment that thrombosis rate in Milano has been reported as high as 30%, pulmonary embolism or DVT. A practical tip again, that if the patient doesn't improve their oxygenation with proning, check for DVTs and, you know, I guess look for pulmonary embolism. And good, I think then if we have hematology colleagues on the phone, Sasha, can you identify them so that
Dr. Billet or
unmute them? On, Millie could unmute them so they can speak.
Just tell me who they are.
Billet?
I don't want to unmute anybody.
Okay, in the meantime, Dr. Garcia, if a pathological specimen shows pulmonary hemorrhage, would it be risky if anticoagulation is started too late? I think that's a very good point. In DIC, the role of anticoagulation is different if slowly progressive versus fulminant course. And then it gives you compliments for great presentations, both Miguel and you. So
Uli, I can speak if you are, I've been unmuted, if you want me to talk.
Good. Who's this, Henny?
Yeah.
Good. Yes, please. Go ahead.
Hi. Okay, so yes.
Introduce yourself. I even recognize your voice, but introduce.
Okay, I'm Henny Billet. I'm the head of hematology here. I put forward the AC protocols, the revised AC protocols, and then the re-revised AC protocols, which should be coming out today. So let me start, I guess, with some of the chat comments that I saw. One, is there any evidence for apixaban? There is good evidence for apixaban thromboprophylaxis preoperatively, as you know, but there's absolutely no evidence. And I don't want to claim that there is for the use of apixaban in COVID coagulopathy. The reason we initially picked apixaban alone was because I was told that they really wanted something oral. For the patients, because they didn't want to inject them and they didn't want to worry about the very initial protocol had both, had a low molecular weight heparin and an apixaban. But then it was put forward as an apixaban. There was a U and cry, which I think was justified. I mean, I think low molecular weight heparin is a very good drug in a certain circumstance. And we're going to talk about the difference between bivalent and this in a second. So the new protocol has your choice. You can use a low molecular weight heparin and apixaban. I want to emphasize this is not for ICU patients. Not for the patients that you have. I think if you have a capability of intravenous, short-term intravenous therapy, that's wonderful. And whether it's bivalve or whether it's heparin, I'm not sure. I mean, I think bivalve is a much better antithrombotic, but as we talked about, there is an anti-inflammatory effect, but the anti-inflammatory effect is supposedly through anti-10A, affect an IL-6, so one would think that apixaban might. There are no data on that. There's some suggestive data that it might have an anti-inflammatory effect. We know that the heparins do. There's not much evidence about valerudin, but there is exactly what Miguel showed. So it's not clear if it's anti-inflammatory versus anti-thrombotic. I've also heard from the Italians, they see thromboses everywhere. They see microthrombi and they see macrothrombi. And so that's the beginning of the pathology specimens that they're starting to do. So we've heard from the pathologists at Milan that there are tremendous numbers of thrombi in their pathology specimens. I think basically, again, this is a non-ICU protocol because I think if this works, it's going to work in those who are not quite so sick. I think by the time you get to the ICU, you need something that's bigger and better, and it could be bivalirudin. I think we don't know, but it's certainly a good option. The one problem is the question of how do you measure it? I mean, how do you even measure the unfractionated heparin? Because unless you're measuring directly anti-10As, which we can get, so is a good option, then you can't measure it by PTT because the fibrinogens are high, the 8s are high. It's just not measurable. We also have not seen antiphospholipids. And in that paper, the antiphospholipids are mostly IgAs and low titer. So that's probably not so significant. And I agree, I don't think there's a huge antiphospholipid component. But to measure bival, if you're doing that through dilute antithrombins, you know, that's if you've worked with Mora and you have a measurement, the real problem is monitoring these patients. We have not seen a lot of bleeding. I know that there's concern from some intensivists about the bleeding. We've not seen a lot. It really is a prothrombotic disease, but obviously we're gonna see some if we start instituting really intensive anticoagulation. I guess that's what I have to say in a nutshell.
Great. No, Henny, this was really terrific. And just sort of message from the ground, thanks for all your efforts here. It's very clear we're practicing disaster medicine.
Yes.
We should discuss all of this. Very important. What is the best possible treatment? But I think being able to give something orally. Last week, we admitted 1,000 patients. I don't know how many of them have a D-dimer over 3, which I think is the cutoff that we accept. Is very important. So great. Millie, if you can hear me, Bo Mitchell is director of pediatric thrombosis. She's also on. If you can unmute her while I go through a few of the other comments here. So Bjora Weiss just added a clinical info here. There are 3 patients with COVID STEMI. Patient 1 needed a very high dose of heparin to achieve anticoagulation. Of course, this is obvious when this happens, we suspect thrombus. Patient 2 had a huge thrombus causing the MI, and patient 3 had acute stent thrombosis. Again, just underscoring, we do see this. But I would say this, although having looked at the entirety of our data here, although everybody sees those STEMIs and myocarditis, when you look at the big picture, we have now about 1,600 COVID admissions to date. And I don't think we have seen a total of 5 STEMIs, for example. And we have only seen 3 or 4 myocarditis, possibly because we're not doing enough echoes.
But Uli, you'd also need to take in account that you won't see because some of the patients have just sudden cardiac death. They found them dead. Are they from hypoxia? We don't know what is the death from.
Yeah, actually in the in-hospital experience, when you define sudden cardiac death as a unexpected arrhythmia outside of respiratory failure, this we have not seen this.
No, I'm saying, but some patients die just, and they're considered respiratory dead. We don't know, are they die respiratory or not? They just found dead.
Yeah.
I understand what you're saying, but I'm just saying
okay.
It will be hard to classify it.
Okay, very good. So I think that just in the interest of time, to respect everybody's times, to sum up the second part here, clearly, COVID is a uniquely pro-coagulopathic state. Clearly, we need to do more study. I think we are, as clinicians, now comfortable to recognize that a D-dimer over 3 requires some form of anticoagulation. There will be different protocols in effect based on availability of drug and ease of administration. I think that's where we are right now. And so I think we have come quite a long way in only 4 weeks since our first COVID cases.
Let me just introduce myself. I just wanted to say hello. I'm Beau Mitchell from CHAM, the hematologist. Oh,
yes.
Hi. We're fortunately not seeing such a high rate of thrombosis in the patients up to 18 or 20, but then it really picks up after 20 years old or more. And we're similar to Henning. We're recommending low molecular weight heparin in the CHAM patients.
Okay, great, great. Thanks for the input. And I will just say the work with CHAM together has been really fantastic because our patients now go to, at least our patients come to you now because we have.
Yes.
So it's been really good. But Miguel or Sasha, if you have something that was missed that you would like to mention now briefly, otherwise we'll close and announce for next week.
I think we're okay.
Okay, good. Great. So then thanks everybody. We were supposed to talk about proning today, but we ran a little bit out of time in a good way. It was a great discussion. So thank you everybody, and we'll send an email on Monday or so about the next journal club next week. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.